Hi everyone, 2J's here. So I came across another teaching and scripture that is clearly off on its perspective and needs to be restored and clarified. So 1 Samuel 16:14, there's certain versions that say, "Now the Spirit of the Lord had departed from Saul," it's talking about King Saul, "and an evil spirit from the Lord tormented him." No evil spirit in the Lord or from the Lord. So there's a few versions that say this. The New International Version, King James Bible says same thing, but the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul and an evil spirit from the Lord troubled him. And then there's a bunch of versions that say this, evil spirit from the Lord. There's no evil spirit from the Lord or in the Lord. So there's certain versions here that have got it right, though. Like, surprisingly, a few of the other ones that are off on some, like the New Living Translation says, "Now the Spirit of the Lord had left Saul, and the Lord sent a tormenting spirit that filled him with depression and fear." See, that makes sense, because that's not saying it's evil, it's tormenting. And we can see that in the days of Pharaoh, God has spirits that can torment. That doesn't make them evil, though, because they're under command from God to punish the wicked. So it's not the other way around. God doesn't send the wicked to punish people, things like that. So these are off. There's no evil spirit the evil spirits go against God, so they don't follow his commands. So that doesn't make sense. So that's off. But a couple of these did get it right. So like the New Living Translation, the way it says, you know, "Now the Spirit of the Lord had left Saul," because I'm doing this to show and prove the once saved, always saved thing, how it's nonsense. It's not the proper gospel, and it's false. It's a false gospel saying once saved, always saved. There are conditions to remaining in the book of life. It says things about your name can be blotted out from the book of life, and it says things about if you keep my commands you will remain in my love, which love is God. You will remain in my God. So there's a condition there that's on us to follow. There's so many clear things and warnings about not departing away from God once you do are given the Spirit. Like Saul, it said he was given the Spirit of the Lord. He was a chosen king. And then it said now the Spirit of the Lord had left Saul. So the Spirit will leave if people turn away from him and become wicked. And then God can send a different spirit to them. He started to disobey God. And when he went to war and got all the animals, he kept all the animals that God told him to slaughter, he told them to slaughter them so that it wouldn't it seemed like a robbery, you know what I mean? It'd be like stealing. You go to war, kill them all, but take all their stuff. Then it comes off as like a robbery as opposed to a punishment from God. So like it was like he was told to just slaughter them. Like, you're not trying to profit off of this. You're doing this as a prophet to try to get a message across for God. But Saul disobeyed, and he kept all the animals, and he brought them back, which that seems more like stealing. You know what I mean? That's more like a commandment breaking. You disobeyed God. And then he's like, we're going to sacrifice them in the temple and this and that. And like, they used to sacrifice, and they'd give the meat to the priests and things like that, and the best would go to the temple and stuff like that, you know. So it obviously displeased God, and that's another thing too. Like, it says that in the end times and things like that, there will be people that will try to prohibit people from eating certain foods and drinking certain things and stuff like that. So it's like, and you see that nowadays when they're all pushing like this, all the vegan and all that, animal rights and all that, right? Because it's like, they're like trying to make it seem like it's ungodly to slaughter animals and eat animals. But the Bible's very clear that God gives those animals for us to use. It's a blessing from God, and we're supposed to give thanks to God for that and ask him to bless it to our body, you know. So it's nice, not like they're trying to do this. So it's like there's clearly scriptures in the Bible that point out how God doesn't prohibit the slaughter of animals, like, you know. So it's like there's like, I understand that they're trying to love all animals and stuff like that, but it's like animals are given to us to use and to eat and to take care of and for many different uses, you know. But like, they're, so them trying to prohibit the use of the slaughter of animals, even though God has commanded the slaughter of animals at times, that's clearly false, and they're on dangerous ground doing that. They're falling into the category of those who prohibit people to eat certain things and stuff like that. So it's clearly not like one of the rules from God that we're not, it's not one of the commands from God that we're not supposed to slaughter and eat animals. So, but it does say things about, oh, if what you eat raises a matter of conscience with your brothers and sisters, then you should keep it to yourself, what you eat and stuff like that. And you're supposed to keep those kinds of things to yourself, because it's basically saying it's not their business, it's not your business, but you don't want to affect their conscience and hurt people. You're not trying to hurt them, you know. But yeah, so I just wanted to point that out too, because it says in the end times that when the Antichrist goes to the temple, they'll put a stop to the sacrifice of animals and the slaughter of animals. So that's connected to the Antichrist trying to change how God allows us and to use animals. And there's even evidence that the spirits can use animals and go into animals, like when they were casted into the pigs, Elisha and the bears, how the Holy Spirit can use animals, angels have with the Daniel in the lion's den, stopping the animals from eating Daniel, and things like that. So there's evidence of the spirit having control of animals and using animals at times too. So that, I don't know if that could be part of why they're trying to preserve certain animals and this and that, because it says when the revelation happens, when the seals are opened, it talks about all the animals that will be killed. And during the Exodus with Moses, there was tons of animals. That was part of the punishment, is the animals got slaughtered. They all got diseased and died and things like that. So that's a way that God either blesses or curses people and takes away from people, is, oh, you're not, you know, you're disobeying, God will take away your animals, slaughter the animals, you know what I mean? So it's taking away what's needed for life. It's so when people try to act like you're not supposed to do that, God, it's a clear, been a thing all throughout the Bible, a consistent thing where God, if you don't obey God, your animals get slaughtered. You get part of your food, your rations, it's a part of the plagues. So that could be part of the reason why they're like, oh, don't kill animals and slaughter animals and blah, 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 you know. Or they're just compassionate out of love. They love animals. I get it. Animals are great, but they are supposed to be used. And God uses them to bless us and also to curse people at times when he, like I said, when they're disobeying. And because you do get these groups of these devils and these groups of beings, these demons that possess the people, they oppress the people, they get all the animals, and then they withhold the food and animals from people. So, like Pharaoh and stuff, when they got all these animals, but then they're starving the people and stuff like that. So then God will inflict the same on them so that they can comprehend what they're doing to people and get disciplined and a perspective and comprehension of how terrible it is what they're doing to people. And then, and then the English Standard Version, now the spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and a harmful spirit from the Lord tormented him. There's another one here, the New King James Version, but the spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and a distressing spirit from the Lord troubled him. That could work. Anyone that doesn't say evil spirit from the Lord, because there's no such thing as an evil spirit from the Lord. Because if it's evil, it's not from the Lord, and it's not under God's command. That's what makes it evil. So that's a total contradiction and deception that's been added here and mistranslated, like, clearly. So I just wanted to point that out. So there's a... I'm just making some points that prove about the false doctrine of once saved, always saved. Because there's so many things. So, like, whoever has my commandments and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and reveal myself to him. That's John 14:21. John 14:23. Jesus replied, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him." Or you could put them in there instead of him. So, like, Jesus replied, "If anyone loves me, they will keep my word. My Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them." Because that's inclusive of women, children, anyone that does so, right? Instead of it makes it more relatable. So, if you keep my command, John 15:10, if you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love. Just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. See? There's a condition there that is on us to live up to in order to remain in his love, which is God. So, 1 John 2:3, by this we can be sure that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. 1 John 5:3, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. 2 John 1:6, and this is love, that we walk according to his commandments. This is the very commandment you have heard from the beginning, that you must walk in love. See, it's very depending and relying on continuing to walk in his love, not just talk his love. You can't just be like, oh, I love God, but then you don't walk. You don't continue to walk in his love. Then that's faith without works. So that's dead. So it all relies on us keeping to him, his way, and his commandments. And there are even examples of those who didn't and fell from God's graces, from Lucifer, the devils, to King Saul. King Solomon fell away. He went his own way. He started following his wife's false gods and the false idols, and he fell away. That's why, you know, the temple was destroyed and the gospel was brought over to the Gentiles to spread it, because, like, clearly the covenant said that he will always put a descendant from David's line on the throne if they keep to God's commands and God's ways. God, we could see that his son Solomon didn't, and then the temple was destroyed, just as Jesus said. He said the stones will, there will only be a stone left and of this, like, upon another, and all that. There are beings who chose to fall away, go their own way instead of God, even after they were said to have been chosen and given the Spirit by God. So, and that's what I don't understand about when I see Israel nowadays. Like, they, even in Israel, they all have their head to this wailing wall, this part of this wall of the old temple, and they're, like, praying to it, like, hoping, oh, that God hears their prayers. And it's like, that wall, that temple was already torn down because it was seen as an unworthy temple of God. So it doesn't make sense that you're still there praying at this desolation of the temple. Like, it's a broken wall. You're at broken stones. That's why Jesus said, this is the temple. He's talking about your body being the temple. Yet they're still so concerned about putting a temple there like building the next temple, which will, I guess, it has to happen to fulfill the scriptures and all that. But it, we're told that will be the Antichrist's temple. They will go in, the Antichrist is going to go in that temple and claim that he's God in that temple. So it's going to be the Antichrist's physical stone temple that's being built. And the, but then after it's just everything is destroyed, I'm not sure if it says that then Jesus will come back and God will dwell in the temple, but it doesn't seem like a temple that the Antichrist that is built. They're claiming that they want to build it for God, but if it's very clear that the Antichrist is going to go to that temple and claim to be God, so and desolate that temple, so that's going to be it appears that it's going to be an unworthy temple as well. The temple's your body, so. That's why Jesus said, oh, there will be a time when you will not worship in this, in here or there, but you will give God the true worship he deserves, you know, kind of thing. So he's telling us to be the walking temple everywhere we go, you know. So, but yeah, so like when I see it, I'm just like, why are these people, like, how can these people not see, like, they're clinging to the old temple that's already been seen as, it's been destroyed. It's already been seen as unfit. For God, like Jesus was not happy with it. He said God was not happy with Solomon turning away to idolatry, and that temple will be destroyed. And then so it's destroyed. Yet I don't know if they re-put some of the stones to make this wailing wall, because Jesus said there won't even be a stone upon another. Like he was basically saying the whole structure will be torn down. Well, then there it seems like they took a couple of those stones and tried to preserve them to make Jesus seem like he was like lying or something, but he wasn't. The whole temple got destroyed. And then apparently they took some stones that are in the area, stacked them back up, tried to save this one little piece of a wall to what? Try to make Jesus seem like he's a liar or something, but it was destroyed. The temple was destroyed. So, like, people, they're still acting like it's a holy, like, relic of God or something, like it's of God. Meanwhile, God tore that temple's been torn down, like, so it doesn't make sense that people are like, oh, at the Wailing Wall with their head bowing to stone, like, again, like, it's that's basically idolatry. You're acting like the stone is holy and righteous and connected to God. It's stone, it can't speak, it can't talk. That falls in the line with making a stone idol. You know what I mean? Like, you're trying to act like, oh, it's the stone, it's so holy. Like, it's, the whole temple was seen as unfit for God, because because the people that built it in honor to him didn't honor him and angered him by turning away. So, you know, and then there's connections to Solomon collecting 666 talents of gold every whatever month from the Hebrews and from Israel, you know. So there is a connection to Solomon with the number of the mark of the beast right there, and to Israel with the mark of the beast, like he turned to sorcery. It says he turned to sorcery. We're told that anyone who practices and turns to such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. And then it says sorcery, and this is, it's very clear, it rebukes like all that sorcery and idol worship and all that. So like, I don't know, it just doesn't make sense to me when I see these people still acting like this temple wall is like holy. Meanwhile, it's the person who built it was clearly fell away. And the temple was destroyed. So, there's tons of different scriptures. We wouldn't be warned to keep to the faith if it weren't possible for us to fall away from the faith. like the warnings, we wouldn't be told to pray to constantly pray that we are worthy to escape God's wrath. If it was like, oh, once saved, always saved, we're already saved. So why would you have to pray to escape God's wrath? And even after you've been saved, so it's kind of like trying to play God to assume that you're saved before the walk is over, before the day comes when God makes the decision of who is raptured and who isn't. So like in that moment, that's when we will know who God pleased with and who's saved and who isn't, you know. So until that point, but what if, you know, it's that, like, people, what if you get saved and then you went, we go to heaven, and then in the future someone tried to turn against God again in heaven, like Lucifer did, then I'm sure God would just cast them out again. You know what I mean? So, and it talks about, like, certain things. Oh, there will be peace for 1,000 years, then something will happen again. And it's like, it just seems like that it's possible. Obviously, it says with all things they're possible with God, you know what I mean? So it's like, when they're with God, it's possible for them to turn against God. But then when they're not with God, they'll get cast out. Then it's no longer possible for them to turn to be in heaven and turn against God, because God has already cast them out of heaven. But you know what I'm saying? So we could already see that just because God gives you a new heart, says, I will give you a heart of flesh instead of stone. So people cling to that and they'll be like, oh, see, you have a new heart, so though it can't turn away from God because it's God's heart. Adam and Eve had God's heart right from the beginning, and they turned against him. You know what I mean? Lucifer and the evil angels were created by God and given hearts from God, and they turned against him and changed their hearts. So why wouldn't we be able to, you know? And then like the other thing was, yeah, like I made a comment here on the one that I see doing this false gospel here, because there's so many points that I make. It's like, because I saw someone claiming there's no evidence in the Bible that those who believe can lose their salvation, but the Bible is full of warnings to not turn back once on the path of life. It's like, you know, there's a dog and its vomit. It says not to go back to your sins, proving that we can and it's possible to. Lot's wife, she was on the path of life. God, you know, chose to save her. She didn't obey. She turned away, went to death. The one hand to the plow, it says anyone who has one hand to the plow and looks back is not worthy to serve, because you can't plow straight lines while you're distracted looking back at your old life. Do not go back and get your things. It says when the destruction comes, don't go back to your old life. Or you'll go to death. It says, like, with those who cling to their lives will lose it. You know, there's plenty of scriptures warning all not to turn back and go back. So, like, the evidence, that's evidence enough that it's possible to. We wouldn't be warned not to if it weren't possible. So people all clearly have the free will to switch up again, change their minds and hearts, even after said to have been given a new one. We're told that when and if people do, it's as if they're crucifying Christ all over again. You know, because you're willingly going against him, so you know that's like crucifying him again. That's like hurting him. That's willingly sinning, willingly going against God. So you're not following the commandment of doing your best to love God and all others as yourself. It says with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. That means your very best, with all your strength. You're doing your very best. Yeah, you slip up. We may slip up sometimes. That's why the repentance. You need to keep repenting and not get discouraged. That's why he says, do not be discouraged. Keep to the faith. You know, it's all about consistently practicing repentance and getting better. It's about your practice and your walk. So it's like we're told that when and if people do, it's as if they're crucifying Christ all over again when they turn away after. So the gospel that they're preaching, that once people choose right, they can't and don't change their minds, hearts, and become corrupted ever again, and can let their guard down, that's like claiming that people can no longer choose to change, have free will, or change their beliefs, and that God makes our choices from then on for us. I think the once saved thing is false. A false gospel. I disagree out of love for all the people who are believing this. Like, if you're one of those people that believes in this, once saved, always saved, I disagree out of love for you and all, with hopes that you consider these scriptures. If you can change your life and heart once, I'm sure you can do it again, and so can God. So God gave Adam and Eve their original hearts, like I said, and they became corrupt and chose wrong. So why would we not be able to do the same? They're human, so are we. You know, even they'll be like, oh, but they didn't have Jesus' blood because it wasn't given yet, and blah, blah, blah. And they'll try to argue all this. But we can see that once it's about continuing to the commandments and walk, to remain in his love. Remain. It says things about your name can be blotted out from the book of life. That means that your name was in the book of life, and then it gets taken out. That shows that the order that it can be taken out, and you can lose that salvation of having your name in the book of life. So even though they had the same, Adam and Eve had the same serpent, the same devil, Satan, influencing them that we do, you know, in the world, they had far less evil influences around them at that time than we do here in the world now, because the Bible says they will create new ways of evil. We can see that, like all these drugs, cocaine, heroin, all these different alcohols and things like that. Those weren't it, that didn't even exist back then, and they fell into temptation, and they didn't even have as many evil influences around them. We do, and they were in a paradise kind of, like, you know. And it doesn't seem, people are always like, that's the contradiction. How is it paradise if there was a serpent there and evil there? You know what I mean? So he corrupted it from being a paradise, and then until they all got casted out, then I'm sure it just became a paradise again. You know, so because like heaven, the word haven is in the word heaven. Haven means safe spot. So if evil is in heaven, then God, it's not a safe spot anymore. So then the war broke out, then it got casted out, then it's a safe spot again, and a haven again, a heaven. So that's why it says things about a new heaven will be made and things like that. So old heaven will pass away and a new heaven, you know. But so so why would we not be able to do the same? Temptations exist in the world, and we can still fall into temptations and corruption until we are given our incorruptible bodies in heaven. We're supposed to keep the armor of God on. And I understand that's what it seems like the desire of why people want to keep the once saved, always saved. It's like they feel like they're trying to protect their salvation. Oh, no one can take that from me because they stick to that one. Oh, no, neither angels nor this or that can separate me from the love of God. So it's like, I don't think it good to assume one is saved before God reveals who is and who isn't during the rapture. That's like trying to play God, you know what I mean? You're trying to make that judgment and decision of who he chooses to be worthy and who isn't. And we're told to pray to be constantly worthy until that time. So that implies that until that time, things can change, you know what I mean? Like, God, so people do so because they believe God is true to his words and promises. But the problem is that most people clearly don't understand his words, promises, and laws, commandments that lead to the fulfillment of them. So the fulfillment of his promises, laws, and words, you know. So one should always have and keep the fear of going against God, even in heaven, because the evils didn't and don't. They don't have a fear of God. That's why they're disobeying him. So it's, even in heaven, it's important to keep the fear of going against God. So lest they be casted out, and you be casted out like the angels, devils, the evils, who choose not to fear going against God. So the fear of going against God turns us away from evil and the snares of death. Do not lose that fear by assuming you've escaped when the moment hasn't come yet. So although we cannot be plucked out of his hands, we can choose to willingly leave being in the protection of his hands and good graces by choosing to willingly sin against him again. So the parable of the sower also points out such falling away and turning away when the persecution and temptation of the world comes. Because it says, like, oh, the parable where it's like, oh, the seeds will be dropped, some will go into solid ground, some will go on cement or, you know, stone and not take. Some will take root, but then when the troubles and the persecution of Satan and the world and all that comes along, then they'll get they get derooted and they come out from the word and they turn back. So they started taking to the word of God. That means that their heart was flesh enough to take to it. They weren't stone. They took to the word, but then the troubles of Satan, devils, and the world came and attacked them, and the persecution came, and then they turned back and went back. So that shows, that parable shows that that can happen to people and does happen to people. Like, even when on the path, it requires dedication and repentance when you slip up and have setbacks from time to time, to not be discouraged and to continue in the faith with a repentant heart. So if everyone who chose right simply continued in the faith, we wouldn't be instructed to continue in the faith. There'd be no need for them to be like, continue in the faith, because you're already saved. So God has you. You're already going to continue in the faith. That's what they're trying to act like. Like people can't turn back and don't or something. And the Bible wouldn't warn us about all those who turn away from God and the faith near the end. So the world, like, we're given that warning. It says many will turn away from the faith. That means that they were in the faith and had the faith in the first place, but then they turned away from it in the end when it got really bad. So that's the the parable of the sower. And the, again, you know, so the world would be much better off than it is, clearly, if everyone who just said, I believe in Jesus, just stayed to that, like, and actually walked the walk, like, people would be better than they are. Not all who confess and claim to believe in Jesus actually do and are saved and walk the walk. So I'm pretty sure that if angels that were once holy can switch up on God in heaven and be casted out, that the same can happen to any human and being that feels that God feels switches up on him and becomes unworthy on earth or in heaven once you go to heaven. So, like, we are also told to pray continuously that we be worthy to escape the coming wrath. Why would even those already saved be instructed to do so if they were already deemed worthy? We wouldn't be instructed to keep praying such things constantly. So, God bless me. So even the one, like, they cling, this once saved, always saved thing, it seems like they cling to that one scripture from, I think it was Paul that said it, where he said, oh, I believe that no angels or no this or no authority or can separate us from the love of God. That's talking about the love of God. That's not talking about the salvation. That's talking about God loves you regardless. Nothing can separate you from God loving you. It's just like the devils. God still has a love for them. He still loves them and wishes they would turn back and come back to righteousness. So they're not, the love is still there from God. They're not receptive of his love. They go against him, so they don't receive that love. That doesn't mean that he still doesn't love them unconditionally and try to do things to get them to come back. That's why God makes things hard for us if we go the wrong way, because he's trying to get us to realize, it says, he lovingly rebukes those who he loves. Because he want, like a father does a child, you want them to learn and make the right choice, so you have to give them a consequence so that it registers that there's consequences to this, so that they don't go that way, so they can comprehend how harmful it is to them. So that's when it's talking about can't separate you from, nothing can separate you from the love of God. It's talking about God's love. No matter what you do, God still loves you, is what it's saying. But that doesn't mean that you're receptive of that love and that you live in that love and walk in that love according to God and his commandments. So it doesn't mean that just because God loves you that you have salvation. God loves the devils. God loves the sinners, us sinners that have all sinned. But it's up to us whether we're receptive of him or not and accept his love and walk in his love, which is keeping his commandments or not. So, and our salvation depends upon that, because our faith without works is dead. So if you don't continue in that walk and aren't persistent and consistent in practicing keeping the laws, repenting when you slip up, with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength with me and mind, which means you do your very best. So when it says that, that's talking about no one can separate you from God loving you. nothing can change that God is love and has love for all his creation, you know. But then it says that after he will claim that he doesn't know them, he's not, they're choosing to be a creation of evil and on their own. So they're choosing to go, his evil is God's creation choosing to rebel against him. That's what's considered evil. So evil is a creation of the created. So it doesn't exist in God, in love. Love is the opposite. So God's the opposite of evil. So when it says that, you know, so it's up to us and to make the choice, because it's like, yeah, although you can't be plucked out of the hand, that's true. Nothing can separate you from God's love, that God loves you, but you can choose to be separate from love, God, and you can choose to willingly sin against him, to leave the protection of his hands, of being protected and living of him, you know, because then it says, if you want to go that way, you can go that way. You can choose whatever you want. That's what free will is. It's like, you want to choose this? That's your choice. That's what free will is. He's giving us a choice. He's not forcing us to make these choices. So the once saved, always saved thing, it doesn't work. It doesn't work with the gospel. That's false. It's a false gospel. Anyone who's preaching that, like, oh, just because you claim at one day that you believe in Jesus and you confess with your mouth, that means that you believe in him. No. Your walk will prove that. Your works will prove the faith. So unless you continue in that walk of keeping his commandments, it says that's what is required to remain. That means to remain means like that it's possible to leave. So I just wanted to make that clear. So I just so there's another restored teaching here, 1 Samuel 16:14, where they're adding again. This is clearly just a lack of comprehension and a misunderstanding of those who translated these versions, or this is the evil again and devils again purposely trying to connect God to evil again, because it says like, oh, an evil spirit from the Lord tormented him. Evil doesn't come from the Lord. Evil is created, a creation of the created going against the creator. So God's not in control of the of their choices that these evil beings make. That's the whole point why they're in hell. And they go to hell because they're choosing to not live according to God, the control of love. So it doesn't make sense that they're, you know, to go that way. And it doesn't make sense to say that we know there's no evil in God. God's not in control of evil. As far as like, yeah, he's the one who is in control of like putting, why they go to hell. But he's not like using evil as servants. Evil is not like servants to go serve for him and punish people. Like that's what it talks about in Job too. Like it tries to make it seem like, oh, then Lucifer came. And then he had an audience among God, and God said, and they had a conversation, and then he's permitted to go smite Job and his family and all this and kill and like torture Paul, basically. That's acting like Satan is still serving God and that God's still allowing Lucifer and Satan to serve. Meanwhile, they're in a war, and clearly Satan and these devils don't obey God, because if they did, there wouldn't be a battle going on at all. They'd be under his control. They're clearly not. Only to a certain extent, there's some sort of battle where they have a domain now that God has changed that environment and made it not good for them, so that they realize this place sucks. We should go back to the love of God. You know what I mean? Like, to love and God. So it's God's drawn the line to show, with outcomes, to show who's God and who's not. If he's God, why would he be making things so torturous for himself? You know what I mean? Like, if Lucifer is God, then why would his environment be like that? Why would anyone want to be in pain and suffering all the time? And causing pain and suffering all the time, you know? And full of hate. That's not a godly quality. Like, that's not God. So like that, like, well, I'm gonna exist. I love death, and I love existing in death and pain. Like, as opposed to God, love is existing in life and pleasure and joy and love. So it draws the line and makes it very clear who's in charge. That's the whole point. It shows that who's a loving father disciplining the son. Those are the evil sons that are choosing to do bad for themselves and others and things like that. So I just wanted to make this clear, because, like, yeah, so there's another restored teaching. 1 Samuel 16:14. I don't know if they're doing this purposely or if it's just a lack of comprehension, of mistranslation. You know, they just don't comprehend these things and get it. You know, for the scriptures to be fulfilled, it says God will send Elijah before the day to restore these things. So we're already warned that there's going to be people with perspective off, and that God's going to choose someone to actually restore the teachings and understand and comprehend and share these teachings to an actual true servant to him, you know. So I'm that's what I'm doing. Anything that God compels me to try to restore, if I see the perspective off, I do my best to share with all to help bring comprehension and understanding to these scriptures, that no one is lost and confused by them, you know. So anyway, much love, peace. I just wanted to share that. I whenever I share these things, it's out of love. I'm not trying to have heated debates with people or embarrass them, or you know, I'm just trying to say, you know, I got love for you and your perspective may be off, so here's some scriptures to consider, you know, like, and maybe discuss them, think about them, you know, and hopefully you can get, we'll get, that's how we get closer to God, by just studying his word. And, you know, like, sometimes we have to revise and go over, and we make mistakes, and sometimes our perspective's off, and then it's so important to pray to God on it and ask him directly to reveal these things to us. You know what I mean? If we have confusions regarding any scripture, I've done that. You know what I mean? Like, I'm like, God, like, if this once saved, always saved thing, like, can you help me, like, understand why there's all these people trying to believe this? You know what I mean? And then he brings me to scriptures that are contrary, and I get immersed in the study of trying to clarify and make sense of it. You know, so you have to interpret scripture with other scripture to see if it lines up. And all the most important thing, like I said, that another mistake that people are making is they're taking lesser prophets as the authority over Jesus's own words and God's own direct words. So, like, the whole I believe that no angels or no authority or no this or no that can separate me from God, that's like Paul. That's not like a direct thing, teaching from Jesus or God. It's Paul. But it doesn't mean that it's any less true. It's just you have to try to grasp his perspective of what he was saying. So nothing can separate you from God, from the love of God, that God loves you. He loves us all. Even when we're sinners, he's sacrificing his son so that we can have, so that as an invite, he still sent his son back to be like, yo, you can come home if you, like, follow dad's rules. You know what I mean? So he's sending that invite. And then you get at the sacrifice of being attacked and put to death and in pain and suffering by these devils who witnessed him sending us the invite back. You know what I mean? So it shows he sent his son, even though we're sinners, that shows he loves us unconditionally. Even when we're sinners, he tries to bring us back. You know what I mean? So, like, but it still doesn't mean that we can be saved until that moment when until that moment comes. You know what I mean? We're not supposed to be playing God, assuming that we're saved. That's like playing God, making his decisions of who's worthy and who's not. Until that moment comes and God deems who's worthy and who's not by rapturing those who are worthy and those, you know. So, you know, you can still, if you're walking according to the commandments with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, then yeah, you can have confidence that you know in your heart you practice those ways. That just still doesn't mean that your perspective may be off and that you may be still off the path a bit. You know what I mean? Like, doesn't mean, like how people, they could still have the desire to be serving God with all their heart, and that's why they're doing the works and try to share their testimonies and things like that, and do the works. They want to have works to back their faith, but if they aren't chosen and don't have the proper perspective and comprehension from God to be a teacher, because it says, not many of you, my brothers and sisters, should become teachers. Those who do will be judged more strictly. So if your perspective's off, I get it. You're trying to do the work to back your faith. You know what I mean? So I'm sure God will credit that to you. He knows your heart, that you're trying, but it's still not loving God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, because you're still not following his instructions that not many of you should become teachers. So you're putting out false teaching still. That's not actually serving him. That's actually having the opposite effect and confusing his people. So that's why it's like, oh, unless you're actually chosen by God as in a teaching position, yeah, I'm not trying to discourage you. You should still do your best. But the problem is there's all these people out there taking every single word like it's directed at them. So they're losing the context of who God was speaking to at the time directly, who he chooses to give as a prophet to give messages to his people. He backs them with signs and things, and power and spirit, and you know, evidence of his spirit in that person. You can see they're walking in love, they have the fruits of the spirit, they're doing, you know, it's evident. And then God makes it evident who he chooses and sends. And that's, everyone wants to be chosen and sent, you know what I mean? So they all want to have the works, and everyone, obviously, it's a nice thought to think like, oh, I'm chosen and sent, but that's out of context. God's very specific that there's the two witnesses, there's Elijah who will restore all the teachings. So that's saying that these teachings are off. That's why in the Psalms it says you can, their throats are like an open grave that lead to death. They speak lies. Not a word from their mouth can be trusted, because their perspective's off. So it doesn't mean that their heart's not in the right place and that they don't want to actually help you and be chosen. But they may not be the chosen person that God knows that they have the heart to do that, or the skills to do that, or the verbal ability to do that, and the gifts to do that. So God knows people's hearts and how he endows them with what powers and gifts he endows them with. So we all have different gifts and things. So not everyone's gift is to be a teacher. To be the teacher, it tells you not many of you should, because you're confusing the gospel. So that's the problem with the church nowadays. And then when someone like me comes along who does finally have some sort of physical evidence of being chosen, I have a signet ring with my name, my name from my parents that was given to me, as well as my God-given name, 2 J's, in a signet ring in the name of Christ. So I come in the name of the Lord, showing that I'm blessed by God and I'm chosen to do this. But all people want to be that. I get that, but we're not all chosen for those tasks. God delegates specific tasks to his specific chosen at times, so not to confuse the people. Because it's like if you're telling a story in a room, you get 10 different people telling the story, they're all going to have different perspectives. You know what I mean? So yeah, that can help, getting different perspectives from different from different sources, but it can also confuse things and mix it up, because, you know, like you pass a story along, details can get mixed up, people's perspectives are off. So that's clearly what's happened here. So God chooses to send the one person who he endows with the power to get the story straight for him, so that it's easier for people to focus on that one focal point, see the authority behind it, that it's truly from God. There's not all this confusion being added from different perspectives and men adding their different things to it, and that's what happens. So I'm just putting it forward. That doesn't mean that I'm perfect. It just means that, you know, that's what I've been chosen for. God's revealing these things. It's clear to me when these things come up. Like, I can just feel it in my spirit. It just raises a flag right away where I'm like, that is not true. Like, that is not true. I can recognize it. Like, God just, red flag, it just goes off. Like, if I see something that doesn't go according to my current level of understanding of where God has me at, perspective-wise, I have a signet ring with my name in Christ to show that I am blessed by Him. I am at that level of anointing from Christ to be in His name. I get Jesus' perspective. I get the perspective that Jesus Christ had to love God and view God and all others as yourself, as a part of yourself, but not as you're the Almighty God. So, like, I get the concept of potential oneness with all, but still two-ness and division until He comes back and separates. So I comprehend that. So everyone has the potential to be one if they choose right and choose God. They have the potential to do that. But the gospel isn't that. It says until that division happens and the two-ness of the goats and the sheep, there will be no oneness. So that's what you see them pushing in Israel right now with this whole temple. They're like, it will be a place where all religions can come and we can all worship together and we'll all be one and realize we're all praying to the same God. No, you're not. There's Muslims, Buddhists, all these different religions in this one area to think that they're all praying to the same God when they're clearly not all of the same God obeying the same commands. The commandments from God. They're not all following Jesus Christ. They're not all praying to the same God and following the same commandments. So that is 100% false deception. Thinking, oh, the world's going to be saved through the unification of all our spirits and this and that. No, we're going to see. The only way that we're going to be saved, it's very clear, is through Jesus. Comprehending the perspective of Jesus. Being baptized into the body of Christ. Becoming an anointed Christ-like vessel with the comprehension that we have the potential to be one, but we're two and divided until the wicked is separated from those considered blameless from God. So, and that can only be done through the teachings of His Son, Jesus Christ. Not through Buddha and the Muslim Allah, God, and all these different confused things. You know, like, what appears to be happening, they're like, oh, we're going to build this temple. That's like the most heated political and religious area in the entire world. And they've always been fighting over this Holy Land. There's been crusades and things fighting to reclaim Jerusalem. And they're fighting for these areas because they think that the stones are holy and the ground is holy that you're walking on and all this. So it's basically idolatry. They cling to the physical world as being the holy thing, not the spirit of that's in the body of the people that are chosen in that area at that time. So what made that area holy is God chose to dwell in that area in His Son Jesus, in His prophets, in His people when they were being His people. The Israelites were being His people and they were very open to God. Now, they've fallen away. It's very clear there's a small remnant. There's still a small remnant. I'm sure God still loves Israel. It says He'll protect. It's His land still. He's chosen that area. And it's no coincidence that it's the country that is an anagram for Israel. So, Israel. Like, God is real. It sounds like guard Israel. Guard Israel. God is real. You know what I mean? See the word play there? So that could be part of the reason why He chose that specific land, because the name of it, it points to Israel. It points to the reality of God. So, you know, things like that. When it's just like Jesus, how I said Jesus's name, Jesus. That was a given name. They were told to name Him Jesus. That's a chosen name. Like Yeshua, which means salvation. And then Yah is in there, which is connected to Jehovah, Yahweh. And then Jesus, G apostrophe S, us, God's us. So it hints at oneness again, that you can be one with God, that God is us. It can dwell in us and be in us when his spirit is in us. Then God's using us as a vessel, so God's us, loves us. But that doesn't make us the Almighty God. It's trying to point to potential oneness again when you live in the unity and spirit of love. But if you don't, you get divided and you become part of the wicked group of the goats and the sheep. So you become, and then it's not coincidence that all these celebrities and people are in this generation are calling themselves the goat. Eminem, oh, I'm the goat, greatest of all time, and it's all prideful and vanity, and they're all calling themselves goats. Who's the goat? Is it LeBron or is it Michael Jordan? No, they're the goat of their time. Oh, they're the goat. It's like people just need to, they obviously don't know the word enough to know goat represents Satan and the wicked group. So, so I just wanted to point this out. Anyway, much love. I hope this helps you come to a greater understanding and that you can accept and restore teachings. And I hope it gains an interest and helps feed your hunger and thirst for the word of God to get clarity on regarding the commandments, to help us keep to his commandments. I hope and pray in Jesus' name that you can come to know God in love and through his son Jesus and get to that point, you know. So anyway, I say this only out of love. Like I said, I'm not trying to disprove people, to embarrass them or make them feel. I do it out of genuine love, loving concern for your salvation and your spirit, so that you aren't confused and you don't spread confusion. Because a lot of the times, I don't get a vibe from a lot of these people that they're trying to deceive people or trying to be deceived and deceive people and spread false gospel. And I just feel like they're trying their hardest to serve God and do the works, but they're not equipped to yet and chosen to, so they're just still lacking the comprehension of the scriptures and they're not chosen to do that. But they're still doing their best. You know, I do get a vibe that a lot of them are still doing their best. That's why I have a feeling like I'm merciful when it comes to that kind of stuff, to that. And God's merciful when it comes to that, I'm sure, because he knows your hearts. He knows if you're actually trying to help people. You know, and just because you got one thing wrong on the thing doesn't mean that some of it didn't speak to someone else and get through them and inspire them in a way. You know, but still, overall, it's just the danger of it, you know, a little truth and then a big lie. If it's not all in, if there's false mixed in, like, that's like a lukewarm kind of thing, you know, where it's like, if that's not all true, then that can easily confuse, you know, like, the devils do that. They'll use a little bit of truth. Like, you see it in movies, you'll see a little bit of relatable truth here and there. Few good quotes here and there, then you find something that raises a huge red flag and you're like, whoa, okay, so they're using that little bit of truth to try to suck you in into believing that they know what they're talking about and that they're on the right path and all this. Then all of a sudden, boom, big turn, big left-hand turn towards the goats, to being left instead of right, you know. So it's just important to, that's why reproving and correcting and sharing these kinds of things when it comes up and discussing them in love, you know, so that people can get a feel for the fruit of the spirit, that you're actually concerned, loving concern for them to try to help them. Because even if you're getting a few things wrong, I still try to view others as my brothers, sisters, and potential vessels for God. You know, like, you're still, you know, you're still created by the same God, but we're also co-creators, so you're also creating yourself. So sometimes people, you know, they're not choosing to be a full creation of God according to his words, because they don't understand God and his words yet. So that's kind of like the thing too, where it's like kind of contradictory, where it's like, oh, if you want everyone to comprehend that you and the gospel, then it has to be made clearer and they have to be given the comprehension. So a lot of the times when it's telling you, like, it feels pointless, they're like, you're told to go spread this gospel all over the world, but it says that God blinds the hearts and minds of some of them, so they're not meant to. And that's going to happen so that his word comes true. So then it's hard to believe that his will that it is for everyone to be saved, because if you really wanted everyone to be saved, you'd give them all the proper comprehension and teaching that can get through to them to get to that point. Which hopefully that's what we're coming to, and eventually, like the scriptures say, eventually they'll beat their plowshares, their weapons into plowshares and pruning hooks and stop doing war and violence. So it does seem like eventually, through the proper teachings, such as these that God gives, people will finally come to see the logic, reason, and relevance in doing so, in doing this, you know, so... Anyway, so it's not that I don't, but that kind of stuff raises confusion. There are contradictory things when you think about it, right? But the thing that people need to try to consider is that God is doing things in his own timing accordingly to fit how people change and the needs of certain individuals. We're all different and have different needs, so our judgment and our choices is affecting the steps that a man makes his plan, people make their plans, God determines the steps. So you're making plans, you're going this way, then God has to try to adapt that much more to try to bring you back. You know, but that's why it says he's patient, because he's given chance after chance. He's like, oh, they're going this way, I gotta go try to bring them back. I got this way, now this person's going that way, I gotta switch up what's gonna get through to them, because they're believing this now, this way, false way now, so now I gotta try to figure out how to get them back over to the truth again. So, you know, the more you resist, the more you're prolonging peace on the earth, peace in heaven, peace in God, all that, you know what I mean? So it's like, and that's what it seems like these devils are doing. They just want to keep confusing people so that they just keep prolonging the time when God says, okay, that's enough. I've told you all enough. You've made your choice. You keep straying. It's on you now. You know what I mean? So that's what hopefully, it's the scriptures testify that even when the city comes down and the city of heaven could be witnessed, they're going to be trying to break into the city and that they're still, but it says they're not going to be permitted, so there's going to be people stuck down on the earth looking up to this city, and they're not permitted because they're still refusing. So it just shows how obstinate and stubborn people can be in going against God and taking to the wrong ways. You know, so I implore you and try to appeal to you, to logic, reason, and to see the logic, reason, and relevance in taking to God's commands for the benefit of all, and, you know, because then you don't do violence against each other, because that's doing violence against yourself. To hurt anyone is to hurt yourself. To be against anyone is to be against yourself, and God, and Jesus, and everyone. It's against oneness, and peace, and love. You know what I mean? So, anyway, much love. Much love. I hope this brings some love, which is God, and some clarity. And yeah, much love. Live to love, love to live. I hope you all have a blessed day and a blessed life, and that we can all make it to eternal life in love and God through our repentance and following of his laws and son. Anyway, much love. Peace. Two J's out.
Do not be surprised at this. The time is coming when all the dead will hear his voice and come out of their graves. Those who have done good will rise and live. And those who have done evil will rise and be condemned. I can do nothing on my own authority. I judge only as God tells me, so my judgment is right. Because I am not trying to do what I want, but only what he who sent me wants. If I testify on my own behalf, what I say is not to be accepted as real proof. But there is someone else who testifies on my behalf. And I know that what he says about me is true. John is the one to whom you sent your messengers. And he spoke on behalf of the truth. It is not that I must have a human witness. I say this only in order that you may be saved. John was like a lamp, burning and shining. And you were willing for a while to enjoy his light. But I have a witness on my behalf, which is even greater than the witness that John gave. What I do, that is the deeds my father gave me to do. These speak on my behalf and show that the Father has sent me. And the Father who sent me also testifies on my behalf. You have never heard his voice or seen his face. And you do not keep his message in your hearts, for you do not believe in the one whom he sent. You study the scriptures because you think that in them you will find eternal life. And these very scriptures speak about me. Yet you are not willing to come to me in order to have life. I am not looking for human praise, but I know what kind of people you are. And I know that you have no love for God in your hearts. I have come with my father's authority, but you have not received me. When, however, someone comes with his own authority, you will receive him. You like to receive praise from one another, but you do not try to win praise from the one who alone is God. How then can you believe me?
It's better to be hit with the truth than kissed with the lie. Oh me, oh my. It's better to be hit with the truth than kissed with the lie. Cheer.
You don't gotta be sleeping with me to see I'm coming. You don't gotta move for me to see you running. You don't gotta be turned on to be feeling something. You don't gotta be turned off to be feeling nothing. I have food to eat that you know nothing about. You're hungry and starving if you're loving to doubt. My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Win with the smirk, diminish a jerk. Do you want to get well? Get up, pick up your mat and walk. Don't let hell steal and see in your soul. Be in control even though some people get old. Don't be evil and cold, blue as sea. Be one with God, two agrees. Waiting for you to see I who speak to you and me fluently.
Oh me, oh my. It's better to be hit with the truth than kissed with the lie. Oh me, oh my. It's better to be hit with the truth than kissed with the lie. Cheer.
Jesus, Yeshua, the light, the truth, and the way. Loves you, loves us more than you do every day. Loves us more than money you spent. The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent. My teaching is not my own, it comes from him who sent me. Blessed is he who's not ashamed of me, who does not resent me. Have I not chosen you, the dozen people?
The world does not hate you, but it hates me, because I testify that what it does is evil.
Everyone who listens to the Father and learns from him comes to me. Everyone who doesn't proves themselves too dumb to see the truth. The apple doesn't fall far from the tree.
Oh me, oh my. It's better to be hit with the truth than kissed with the lie. Oh me, oh my. It's better to be hit with the truth than kissed with the lie. Cheer. Oh me, oh my. It's better to be hit with the truth than kissed with the lie. Oh me, oh my. It's better to be hit with the truth than kissed with the lie. Cheer.